The next presenter is already known for us from yesterday, and Jonathan for Blerkom. And it has a very long title, Specific Elements Determine Fertilizability and Development Competence During the Preimplantation Stages and How They Can't Be Recognized in Patients with Persistent Fertilization Failure. Please, Jonathan.
Well, thank you very much. In the idea of translational medicine, of how we can get information that from observations that then go to basic research, and then from the basic research back to the clinic for utilization in recognizing problems in fertilization or in embryonic development. And I'm going to give an example today of how this can be used and how we've used it to identify a specific problem in fertilization in IVF, and how that information led to basic research, which then goes back to the question of how can you detect non-invasively the presence of a problem, and I'll discuss the problem in a minute with fertilization. And a number of years ago, we were interested in a specific phenomena, which I think we did publish in 2013 in RBM Online, and I think if you want the details of this, I would recommend looking at this paper. And the phenomena that we had seen was, I think, is overlooked and mentioned in the paper by, I think, mostly all IVF programs, and that is that you have a normal egg that is inseminated by conventional IVF, seems to be okay, doesn't fertilize, and when we look really closely at these, and I talked about this last year, here, that you have sperm on the surface of the plasma membrane of the egg, had penetrated through the zona pellucida, had seemed to be normal in every respect, except it just stayed there on the plasma membrane without doing anything, did not penetrate. And you say, well, how common is this? And it turns out, if you look at eggs that have not fertilized, and we've gotten eggs from a number of programs that send them to us fixed, and we looked at them, and to date, we've now examined 529 metaphase II unfertilized eggs. That's a lot. And of those, approximately 63% had sperm on the membrane. So this is like the lottery where you have five or six numbers and you win $10 million and you get only four and you get nothing. So the egg is normal. The sperm, by all means, are normal. It has gone through the zona pellucida, it has undergone the acrosome reaction, and it stops. So the question is, as a phenomena, it's not uncommon. If you start looking at eggs that don't fertilize instead of throwing them out, you will find that in many cases, the sperm have gotten through. So the question is, what is on the surface of the egg that is involved in penetration, involved in sperm attachment, that has gone awry in these cases? And this is just examples where you can see a sperm head here. Here's actually two. Here's one stained for DNA. This is the surface. And in this case, you actually have three sperm heads. The eggs themselves have no features which would indicate that they're abnormal in any way. So we started looking at this in a number of ways to try to identify what could be on the cell surface that could be interesting to look at. And I'm going to talk about one of the elements, not how we came about this, because we were actually looking at this particular molecule for something entirely different related to implantation. And what we found, in fact, in these cases is that there's a gangliocyte. And the gangliocytes are really interesting molecules. They're ancient molecules, in a sense. They're on cells that go back to Drosophila, go back to nematodes, even to bacteria. And they serve as cell surface receptors, in some cases very primitive receptors. But in somatic cells, they're receptors, for example, for viruses like poliovirus. They're receptors for toxins like cholera toxin, diphtheria, botulism, etc. And it's a way that the cells can, viruses can attack cells and be integrated. And they're very simple molecules, and they sit on the cell surface. And what we found, in fact, is that the human egg and the mouse egg, and I'll show you some other species, are covered with domains of these gangliocytes, and they fluoresce green here because we use a probe of cholera toxin Now, it's not the toxin, the pathogenic molecule, it's the carrier, the cholerotoxin B molecule, which binds to these gangliocytes, specifically to a gangliocyte called GM1. And in normal eggs, in human, for example, here, the distribution of these domains of these gangliocytes is pretty uniform. And these are normal eggs, for example, which have fertilized, and this is just showing the same egg rotating around 360 degrees. So when a sperm comes in, it sees these domains and we think binds to these initially. This is the initial binding. And then once that happens, the sperm can undergo changes with other proteins, which I'll show you in a moment, and fertilization can occur. In the eggs where we see sperm on the cell surface, the phenotype is completely different. And we described this in the earlier RMB Online paper. And what you see are clusters of these domains, of this particular GM1 that we can identify here, here, and here. But you have large gaps on the plasma membrane, here and here, for example. So if a sperm comes in this way, and where a sperm enters the egg through the zona pellucida is random, it's not specified, and hits this region here, there's nothing to attach to. That was the notion. And so even if other proteins involved in the fertilization process are present, the initial binding, like a virus binding to a cell, there's nothing to bind to. So this was the initial notion of what we had seen. Here's another example. Here's another example. And here are other examples which are common, actually, in the eggs of older women where you have severe clustering of these domains of this particular gangliocyte. This. And this is very common in the eggs of older women. Okay, so what has it do to fertilization? And what you see is the sperm nucleus here, and it is approaching the membrane. It's right here. It actually binds the tip of the sperm or the lateral surface of the inner acrosomal membrane binds to the cell surface. And you can see this region here where the sperm is bound to the cell surface and these domains of GM1 seem to aggregate towards the sperm nucleus. And this was a very common finding. If you have the sperm coming here, for example, in this region, there's nothing there to bind to. And the sperm just sits, doesn't move around. So with this in mind, this is the interaction. We started looking at this in more detail. And this is a human egg. And you can see here, well, maybe you can see it. There's a sperm head right here where the big red arrow is. This is where it's bound. And when we look at this region where the sperm has attached to, what has happened is that these domains of this gangliocyte seem to have been pushed aside or internalized. And once that happened, it reveals other proteins, CD9 folate 4 receptor, the integrin alpha 6 beta 1 in this region. So you have proteins that are known to be involved in fertilization that co-localize with these domains of this particular gangliocyte. And when a sperm interacts with that region, it clears out the GM1 gangliocyte and exposes these proteins, which are now involved in the very robust binding of attachment of the sperm to the membrane that leads to penetration. And in the absence of the gangliocyte here, for example, there's nothing to attach to. And so these proteins that are involved in fertilization are still present, but the ability for the sperm to attach seems to be missing. Now we see the same thing in the mouse. This was recently published last month in RMB Online, and this is in mouse. And what we see here normally occurring is there's a domain on the surface of the mouse egg, shown here, near the polar body, where a sperm never attach. And this has been known for quite some time. And if we look at live cell imaging of fertilization, you can see sperm that have come attached here or enter in associated with the membrane here and sort of skip along this what we call a non-permissive domain here where the polar body had been. It's been knocked off and then find a place to attach over here or just sort of skip and then just leave. So here's a sperm that's comes along and nothing to attach to, and then it comes to this region and attaches. And when we look at this, we find the same phenomena going on. So here in DNA staining is this domain that naturally occurs in rodent eggs. And so this is a region which we don't see in the human, which is common in rodent eggs, especially in the mouse, where it is refractory to sperm attachment. And so when we looked at these guys, very similar to what happens in the human, this domain is free of this ganglioside GM1. There's nothing there, nothing there. No, it's the same egg. So this is the region that is refractory. We can use high-resolution confocal microscopy to look at the super resolution, to look at the organization of these domains, and each of these is one of these sort of spots that you'd see in normal confocal, and then it's composed of multiple domains of this particular molecule. So it's a region where you have sperm attachment occurring, and it is completely absent in this region. However, the other proteins I mentioned, the integrins, the folate 4 receptors, CD9, et cetera, are present, and that's what this is showing here. So this shows the mouse sperm binding to one of these domains here, like this would be this one and this one here, and you can see how they go on the cell surface and there are regions for attachment. So a lot of things change when the sperm enters, same in the mouse, on the permissive regions. This is a permissive region here, for example. This is mouse. And again, you see this displacement or removal of the gangliosides and the exposure of other proteins that are involved in fertilization, which include folate 4 receptors, CD9, etc. So this was an interesting mechanism, and it said, okay, why is it natural in the mouse, and why is it pathological for fertilization in the human? And what we found is that the density and distribution of these are in what are called lipid rafts, lipid raft microdomains, is enriched with this ganglioside, is directly associated with sperm attachment competence. And that these microdomains may be a common and almost antique form of non-species specific binding for sperm, docking. So we make the distinction between the ability of a sperm to dock and the sperm to attach. Attach is involving other proteins which are involved in bringing membranes in juxtaposition for fertilization and penetration, whereas this is just a docking site. And so the GM1 microdomains may be a common non-species specific site for sperm docking. And if you imagine the sperm as a virus and these domains as docking sites for a virus, it's a very similar analogy. And we've seen this now in human and mouse, and it's now detected in other species, including the pig, rabbit, cow, sheep, dog, cat, deer, and bear. You say, well, why bear, right? I mean, where are you going to get bear oocytes? Well, if you live in Colorado, there's a lot of hunting, and no one wants to eat bear, but they do the stuff them. And so if you know people who do taxidermy, and you can say, well, if you're going to stuff a bear and throw out the rest, can I have the ovaries? And they say, take them. And so you can get some exotic species, both deer and bear, and most recently elk. So this seems to be a common phenomena that we see among all species. So GM1 microdomains and exposure of cell surface proteins associated with robust sperm attachment and binding and penetration, and these are the ones I would mention in particular, how is it regulated? And I want to show you now that the mitochondria and bioenergetics in a particular region, this right under the membrane, okay, is one of the major features that determines the fertilizability of an oocyte, even if it's normal in appearance, and also if it has normal levels of ATP production or ATP content. So we've had this notion that nitric oxide in the subplasm level cytoplasm may be a regulator of mitochondrial function. And nitric oxide competes with oxygen, like carbon monoxide competes with oxygen in mitochondria, and can regulate the amount of ATP produced. Of course, with carbon monoxide, you're dead. With nitric oxide, you're not so dead, but you still have problems. So the question was, could nitric oxide compete with oxygen at the level of cytochrome C oxidase to reduce the electrical potential across the inner mitochondrial membrane, which you've heard about before, which drives ATP production? And this could result in a highly local ATP deficit right under the membrane, which may include reduced focal concentrations of phosphate, inorganic phosphate. Inorganic phosphate, and I talked about this, I think, about 2 years ago here, is an important regulator of kinase activity. And inorganic phosphate doesn't come from culture media. It comes from the hydrolysis of ATP. From ATP to ADP releases inorganic phosphate, and 30% of the ATP that is metabolized in a cell produces phosphate, which is then required for kinases to function. And there are a lot of kinases in the membrane and in the space between, in the area right below the membrane. These are where signaling occurs. So not only can you have an ATP deficit, but you can have a deficit in phosphate, which then reflects in kinase activity in a variety of kinases, which can, in fact, impair development or make it abnormal. So resulting in a highly local ATP deficit, which may include reduced focal concentrations of inorganic phosphate in subplasm and cytoplasm, that affects kinase activities and proteins involved in formation of lipid rafts, including those containing GM1, which is an energy-dependent requirement to get this molecule in the cell membrane. And we went back to work that was done and published in 2008, which showed that there was nitric oxide produced by cumulus cells, and that the nitric oxide went through the transzonal processes into the subplasmal level cytoplasm. So we wanted to see if we could identify this in a living state. And this is shown here, well, actually shown in the next slide. But in this case, what we're looking at is nitric oxide that we can detect. And this is using a fluorescent intracellular nitric oxide reporter. And in cells which have high polarized active, very active mitochondria that are orange stained with this JC1 probe, right under the membrane, you can see nothing. There's no evidence of nitric oxide in the subplasmal level cytoplasm. When we go to an egg like this, where you have regionality, so a region here where you have high polarized mitochondria producing presumably higher levels of ATP locally and phosphate, what you find is that that region is negative, where in here, which is kind of off the scale, you don't see much these high polarized mitochondria. They're there, mitochondria are there, but they're much lower polarized because nitric oxide is present here and competing with oxygen. In this case, there's nothing. And this is not atypical of eggs that we find where we find very scant levels of this ganglioside. It is scattered around. And when we look at the cell under the cell surface and we're looking for high polarized mitochondria, there's nothing there. Mitochondria are there, but they're all low activity. And in these cases, you find that intracellularly that the levels of nitric oxide are actually quite high, as is shown here. So we want to do a little bit of different assay, and here is an assay which, where we look at in live cell imaging, we can see that this is the normal distribution of these ganglioside, so this is presumably a normally fertilizable egg. And when we look for, and this is reverse imaging, when we look around the cell surface, we see nothing. This is just it's dark, there's no indication of any sort of levels of nitric oxide that we can detect. And then if we look at another egg, which is this one, which has a very scant binding, and you can see this region shown here, there's just, you know, the sperm comes in, if there's nothing to bind to, that we find that, in fact, there are very high levels, which in fact the intensity had to be reduced to display this around the entire circumference of nitric oxide. So nitric oxide coming from the cumulus cells seems to suppress energy metabolism, which suppresses the ability to incorporate these domains and stabilize these domains that have this ganglioside in the membrane. So does the level of intramolecular hypoxia, how does this mean anything in the context of biology? So does the level of intrafollicular hypoxia influence subplasmal level bioenergetics? In other words, what is the oxygen status of follicular fluid, what the oocyte lives in? And could it be that, in fact, that in certain conditions where it's low, the presence of nitric oxide has a much more exaggerated effect because oxygen levels at the right under the cell surface are low to begin with. And now you add the nitric oxide, essentially the region under the membrane is anoxic. And that's not so good for oxidative phosphorylation. in the case of mitochondria. And so this is the paper I would refer to that we published that showed that intrafollicular levels of oxygen concentrations were less than 1% to about 4.5%. And we related this to aneuploidy, and this was confirmed by other people as well. Okay, thank you. So how do you determine and look for hypoxia in living eggs without having to do anything that is too dramatic?
You have 3 minutes more.
How much? 3 minutes?
Okay.
So basically the answer is that you can use a variety of probes, and we've used several of them, and they're listed here. What we do is we take aspirates of, as they come out of follicles, we put them into a tube with the egg in the bottom, and we have, an oxygen electrode that's right here, and it measures oxygen content of follicular fluid. And at the same time, we use a variety of probes, but I'll just show one for time, that says that we can detect the levels of hypoxia in a living cell, living oocyte, living embryo, and this is a mouse to show that it's doable. And what you find is that the embryos are screaming fluorescence in 1% and go to 18%. It's much less, 5% here. So there's a gradation that tells us something about the state of oxygenation in a living cell, in an oocyte or in an embryo. And when we do the embryos, what we find is that with this particular probe, that you have, you can see that you go from 9.4 to 1%, and as you go to more hypoxic conditions, the fluorescence increases. When we look at living oocytes, coming right out and measuring it, we find that at 4% oxygen, cumulus cells and oocytes staying relatively low. When we go to 1%, they're much higher. And so at follicular aspiration, human oocyte and cumulus are normally severely hypoxic. This is a probe from Thermo Fisher, and you can see the oocyte is essentially about 1% oxygen. So if there's nitric oxide around, this is a problem, and that's going to cause issues with the formation of these domains. Okay, so I'm not going to go through this screen. However, I'm going to get to the point of, are there ways of determining the status of the organization of the membrane with respect to fertilization without having to do these types of experiments, knowing that hypoxia is the normal state, that nitric oxide is usually present. And so we did a screen of proteins that are involved in follicular fluids and follicular fluid development and development in the follicle. And we isolated several that were interesting. HIF, Humira, which I'll talk about, AMPK, and the mitochondrial transcription factor, NFK-beta. And what we found that this protein, hypoxia upregulated mitochondrial movement regulator, that's the acronym for this, is HIF-dependent, which is an important transcription factor, and regulates mitochondrial transport, distribution, and function. And we found that where you have these eggs that have virtually no capacity to bind a DACA sperm, that the level of this particular protein is about 60 to 80% lower in severely hypoxic follicles. So that's a marker, but you're not going to do this. You have to kill the cells. So we wanted to know whether or not there was a, I'm not going to go over the CRISPR experiments, and we wanted to know whether or not there was a expression. And the answer is there are three cumulus phenotypes. Actually, I don't see that slide on here. If you take, and it's not going to work for ICSI, but if you take an egg and do regular conventional IVF, you will find three distinct phenotypes. The first phenotype that's evident from the cumulus cells, independent of the oocyte, in about 6 hours is a monolayer of cells with proliferative spreading and outgrowth. The second type is a cluster, just a bunch of clusters of cells. The third type is no attachment whatsoever. The first cell type, this monolayer of cells that you can see very early, is associated with normal levels of expression of hypoxia, important regulated proteins, including this Humira protein. And those eggs, when you look at their cell surface, it's normal. The GM1 distributions are normal, and so these are fertilizable. The ones that are not fertilizable are the ones where you have cumulus cells that have not really attached or just partially attached, have done nothing in terms of outgrowing, and those cells are a good proxy for an egg that has deficient domains of this ganglioside And if you fertilize that, what will happen is that the sperm will not go anywhere. They'll just stick to the surface. And I'll just end by saying that once you can identify these as interesting proxies, the result is that if you say, well, I'm going to do ICSI on these, and the problem is that the deficiency in GM1, this ganglioside, persists in the embryo. So it's not just localized to the oocyte, it persists. So you can do ICSI, you can fertilize these eggs, but what happens is that the ganglioside, which interacts with sperm, is the same ganglioside that is going to cause blastomeres to interact with one another. And a deficiency in the oocyte, which is rescued for fertilization by ICSI, results in embryos that divide, but they have very poor intercellular communication, and they stop dividing. And I think one of the bases of embryos which stop dividing during cleavage is they can't communicate with one another properly. They don't compact properly. This is after ICSI. So the defect that you see in the oocyte that has prevented fertilization, that you overcome with ICSI, is manifest during the preimplantation stages and still results in developmental lethality. So I think we don't see that particular slide, which is unfortunate. Ah, here it is, sorry. I'm just thinking. This is the slide. So this is the phenotype where you have a normal development of these GM1 domains. This is the type of outgrowth you get. These are normal. This is about 4 to 5% oxygen in the intrafollicular environment. And about 1 to 2%, you get these clusters of high activity, but regions of low activity corresponding to these absence of these domains. And what you get is this phenotype where the cells are clustered and there's very little outgrowth. This one, which is the worst, these are just clumps of cells which have attached but have done nothing. And these are found in the persistent hypoxic follicles where the intrafollicular oxygen concentration is less than 1% when you measure it. So these are fairly good proxies for the developmental status of the egg. You can see this, I would say, within the first 6 hours after fertilization. Now, when you do ICSI and you have cumulus cells, forget it, because that all these interactions are lost. So this is an interesting way of going from an observation for research and back to detecting it. And I just would end by saying that, of course, people have asked me, so well, why don't you just use the probe, which is a cholera toxin probe, to do this? And you say to clinicians, well, we're going to put some cholera toxin on your eggs to look at the surface architecture of this and just do a quick fluorescent look. They say, are you crazy? Not going to happen. Of course, it's cholera toxin B, which is just another protein. It's like albumin. It's internalized, metabolized, and disappears. So it's not toxic. It's not a pathogen. But still,
can we conclude, please?
Yeah, having any cholera toxin is not a good thing. So, but this is a way of looking at the origin of a defect in eggs that we can detect non-invasively by the behavior of the cumulus cells. Okay.
Thank you very much, Jonathan, for very interesting information.